Hey guys, there's JJ back with you today. So what I'm going to start doing from here on out is I'm going to start showing build tutorials on a progressively more advanced basis as time goes by. Here a couple weeks ago, I showed you how to do just your basic macro coil for those that are first getting into building. I figured the next step in progression that most people take is just this plain Clapton coil. Now, out there on YouTube, there's a billion and one Clapton coils, but I figured if I'm going to be a one-stop shop for coil build tutorials, this is probably something that needs to be covered on the channel. That way you can come in here and literally follow it from step A down to step 5Z, and we'll progress as new coils come out. So let's go ahead and pop on over to the build table and we'll show you the tools that you're going to need today. I will be doing a slightly different version of the Clapton coil, slightly different method, but we'll show you what I'm talking about here in just a second. Okay, so first and foremost, we're definitely going to need our wire. As normal, I'll be using kidney puncher wire. For the core, I'll be using 26 gauge Canthal, and for the wrap wire, I will be using 36 gauge Nichrome 80. What you choose to use is completely up to you. This is just the combination that I like to use the most. You'll definitely need some snips to cut your wire, some pliers that'll come in handy for straightening your cores. You'll definitely need your wick and scissors. Always have an ohm meter on hand. If you don't have a standalone ohm meter, if you have a fairly accurate ohm meter on your mod, that will suffice, but I really advise getting a standalone ohm meter. You're going to need something to wrap your coils with. I will be using a coil master. Ceramic tweezers, again, are optional, but they do make things a little easier. And for this method, we'll be needing like a little clip. Now, you can do this freehand. The clip just makes it to where you don't have to worry about holding it at any certain angle, holding your wrap wire at any certain angle. And it basically turns it into a one-handed operation. Where all you do is worry about controlling the drill. But we'll get more into this in a second. And of course, you'll need your RDA, which in this case, I'm using the Firebird RDA from Phoenix Box Mods. Oh, and last but not least, definitely you'll have to have a drill for this. So we're going to pop over to Steam Engine and see what we need to do for this. As you can see, if you watched my last video on the Steam Engine tutorial, you'll see that the layout has changed a little bit. It's kind of like what I was saying, that that Steam Engine updates fairly often. So if things change from look to look, it happens. There's not much that you can do. The widgets, for the most part, I've gone through the widgets, really haven't changed. He just gave it a fresh new look. So let's go ahead and go on into the wire wizard. And we're going to go into the wire builder and tell it that we're making a Clapton coil. So we're going to come in here and tell it that we're making a Clapton. And we know that our core wire is just going to be a single wire with Canthal, and we're using 26 gauge. Again, you can use either the up and down arrows to control, or you can just highlight the number and type in whatever gauge you're working at. If you're using the metric system, you can, your wire is measured in the metric system. You can type in whatever your wire measurement is over here in the metric side. For our wrap wire, we're using a single wire. Now we are using Nichrome 80 in this particular build. Obviously adjust this for whatever wire that you're using. And I am using 36 gauge. So let's go ahead and pop that to 36. The inner diameter for the coil that I will be making is a 2.5 millimeter inner diameter. So we're going to change that to 2.5. And for the wraps, well, this is where it gets a little funny. So it all kind of depends on what you're shooting for, what your RDA can hold, so on and so forth. I'm going to shoot for about a 0.7 dual coil. So that's going to mean that I'm going to need to make these coils about 10 wraps a piece. And that gets us to a resistance total per coil of right at 1.4 ohms. So when you divide that by your total number of coils, in our case two, 1.4 divided by two is 0.7. So that's kind of where we're shooting for. You can feel free to play around with these numbers and it'll get you an idea as to how many reps you need, if you need to adjust your inner diameter, you know, whatever the case may be. But let's go ahead and pop on over to the build side and get started on this. Now, I am working with a brand new camera layout, so I apologize in advance if this gets a little wonky. I'm going to do my best to keep it stable and usable and try to keep you guys from having to take Dramamine from massive motion sickness. Now, for however you're wanting to place your wrap wire is up to you. Some people will tell you pull out so many arm lengths for however many inches. Me, what I do is I set mine, it's actually behind the camera a little bit, upright on the table, and I just have it wedged in to where it will automatically spool out the wire as it's needed. You know, whatever works best for you. For our core wire, since we're doing two coils that are going to be 10 wraps, you're not going to need a whole lot of wire for this. So I'm just going to pull out about 10 to 12 inches worth. I don't need a whole lot. So about that much should work just fine for what I'm needing. I'm going to set that off to the side. Now, first and foremost, is you're going to want to straighten your cores. Anytime you're working with these more advanced builds, you're going to want your cores as straight as you can get them to begin with. And as they come off the spool, they're going to be a little curved, especially with the smaller spools. They're going to be really, really tightly wound, and so they're going to be nice and curly. The easiest way is just to stick one end into the chuck of your drill. If your drill doesn't close down all the way to where you can get a nice tight grip, just bend a little L, you know, a little crook into the end of the wire to where you can have that trap between the jaws of the chuck, and that way you'll get a nice snug, secure fit. I'm going to back this camera out just a little bit so you can see on both sides. The other side of the wire, you're just going to grab it with a pair of pliers. You're going to pull it tight and you're just going to give it a couple spins. You don't have to spin it long, you don't have to spin it hard, but don't let go over here with your pliers before you run your fingers down them. When you get your fingers to the pliers, let go of the pliers and you'll feel that wire kind of recoil in your fingers. If you let go of those pliers before you do that, you'll get a recoil effect right here on the very end and it'll get a little wave going on, and that can be kind of a pain in the rear to work with. So try to let it recoil in your fingertips and that'll prevent that from happening. Now, I am using a swivel system for this. You don't have to. It just makes it a lot easier. If you're going to use this method, I would suggest a swivel system. But you can do this freehand. And if you would like to see this done freehand without any sort of swivels or special tools, by all means, just pop into the comments down below and let me know that you're interested in seeing this done with the freehand method. But all I'm doing right now is I'm just bending a little bit of a hook into this wire. And that's just so I have something to hook onto my swivel. And it's gonna look just like that. I just hooked that onto my swivel and get ready to go. So I've got that hooked on. Now let me see if I can move this camera a little bit. I've got a Yoda back behind the camera, so he kind of interferes with my camera movement just a little bit. But here we go. So let's get that hooked back on there. And all we're going to do is we're just going to take our wrap wire and give it a couple quick wraps around the very end of this wire, of this core wire. It doesn't have to be fancy, it doesn't have to look pretty, just something to allow it to grab on when it's in the chuck of the drill. So there we go. I'm just gonna tighten this up in the chuck. Get that nice and tight. pull that. And all I'm going to do is I'm just going to get this spun out just a little bit away from the chuck. And what that's going to do is that's going to give me room to attach this clip. Now I'm going to try to get this to where you guys can see a little better. Let me try zooming in on this. Let me take it out of autofocus. There we go. Let's see. So y'all can see nice and clear what's going on here. Okay, so here's what we're looking at right here. And basically all we're wanting to do is we're wanting to take our clip and just clip that wire at a 90 degree parallel with the core wire. So as long as you've got this fairly close to 90 degrees, this will work. And then you just pull it tight and you're just going to let it spin itself. Now, if you see that it's starting to go, you know, not quite as tight, which we can see here that it's not really tight enough, you're just going to take this, kind of push it back on the line and just recenter it. Just back angle it just a little bit. And we should be able to go full speed from here on out. Okay, I'm not sure how good that's going to show up on camera. Let's see if I can zoom in just a little bit more. Wow, I can really zoom in a lot on this camera. That's kind of impressive. So let me get this in here. Okay, it's not going to focus real, real good. I will get you guys a macro shot of this using my DSLR to show you exactly how tight this is coming out. But in the meanwhile, let me go ahead and back this out. And we'll go ahead and run down this line so you can see exactly how hands-free this is. I mean, it does all the feeding itself. It does all the spacing itself. If you want to put a little weight, if your clip has a hook on it and you want to put a little weight on there, you can. Like, for instance, if you wanted to use this little this goon cap that I've got laying here, we can hook that on there. If I can see it, there we go. Let's get that hooked in there. All right, where'd it go? There we go. Okay, so I've just got that weighted down, and that'll just hold it a little bit steadier as it's running. And now you can sit back and relax and vape the entire time that it's running its way down. This will work with, you know, this little foot long strand. It'll work with a 20 foot strand, you know, however long that you're wanting to work it. Now I'm going to try to follow this as much as I can without getting you guys seasick, all the way over to my swivel, which apparently that's about as far as it's going to go. But my swivel ends right there in the corner of the screen where my finger is. So I'm going to run the wire to about a half an inch or just a little closer to that swivel. And I'm going to cut that wire off right about there, maybe a little bit closer. And I'm just going to cut this wrap wire off just right about here. And I'm going to go ahead and spin it the rest of the way to let that wrap wire get wrapped all the way around to cut off exactly what I need. I'm going to wrap it just a little bit extra so it's on there nice and tight. And there she is. Okay, so let me get this straightened back out. Again, I apologize. I am working with a new camera setup, and I'm not quite sure how I'm going to do this in the long run. But I'm going to pause this real quick and swap over to the macro camera so you guys can see how this is coming out, how tight it is, and what you're going to look for. Okay, so here we are with the macro cam. You can see that we've got our strand here. I'm going to try to zoom this in so you guys can see exactly how tightly this is wrapped. Let's see exactly how close I can get this from this distance. And let's focus it in just a little bit. Oops, wrong way. A little bit too far. Come on. I'm trying to do this all without doing massive cuts and edits, so you guys can see exactly, you know, what I see. But we can see that there's a little bit of spacing in here. Not a whole lot, though. You know, considering that it's being done quickly, easily, and with one hand, it's actually not bad. And anytime you're doing a Clapton wire, you're always going to have a little bit of springing action because of the nature of the wire. It's going to kind of spring out and space itself just a little bit. But that's pretty tight when it comes to a Clapton wire. Now, it does cause a small issue whenever you're going to wrap it because it likes to spread out those Clapton wraps. But it doesn't cause too terribly much of a problem. So we're going to go ahead. Again, this is what you're looking for your core wire, you know, for your finished wire. We'll go ahead and move back over to the build table and get this built up and get it installed. Okay, so somehow or another, I lost the audio during this segment right here when I was doing a transition. So I'm just going to do a narration overlay on this. But basically what we're going to do here is we're going to go ahead and take the wire out of the drill. You're going to want to use caution when you've got the wire out of the drill, because if you handle it too roughly, you're going to pull the wrap wire and cause it to gap a little bit. So make sure that you exercise a little bit of caution here. Ideally, you're going to want to snip off any hang edges, you know, any rough wire that's sticking out from the core wire. And that prevents it from getting snagged. Now, we're going to do this with a 2.5 millimeter mandrel. In this case, I'm using the Coil Master with a 2.5 millimeter mandrel. And we're just going to get this set up, stick it through the hole, and get it prepped. Now, when using the Coil Master, be careful of this gnarled screw that I'm showing here, because if you're too rough with it, it'll pull the spacing of that wrap wire out. So be prepared if that happens. And we're just going to do two coils with 10 wraps. So. Okay, so we've got the coils wrapped. We're going to go ahead and press it in and make sure that that coil is nice and tight together. And we're going to offset this leg a little bit, and that's just going to allow it to sit more even once it's mounted inside the RDA. Okay, so there's the first coil done. We're going to repeat the same steps for the second coil. Again, if you have a little bit hanging off, just go ahead and cut that off before you start the second coil wrap. And just hold that in place with your thumb, and again, just wrap your 10 wraps or however many wraps that you're doing for your particular coil. Okay, again, press in once you've got your wraps, and that's going to get you that nice tight coil, and offset the legs to allow it for better seating. Now, me personally, I know approximately how much is needed for my legs to clear and not stick out too far on the other side of the RDA to prevent it from shorting out on that opposite coil. So I always try to pre-trim that second coil. Now, I'm going to go through and mount this in the negative hole, and I always try to do the skip a post hole method. So using the four post design, I'm going to put it through the negative post. I'm going to skip the positive post closest to it and mount it through the positive post furthest away. That allows it to be better centered. Be careful when you're tightening the screws down on this, because if you over tighten, you can and will snip the coil legs. So just exercise a little bit of caution. I'm using the mandrel here to try to hold it in place and keep it centered, and I'm going to just kind of press it in and pull it away from the post holes a little bit, and then snip off the excess on the other side. Again, once you get used to your RDA, you'll know for your positive lead about how much you can leave on there without it hanging through. Because once you're installing that second coil, it's a little difficult to snip that positive lead due to clearance issues with your initial coil. So I'm just centering it up here. I'm going to tighten down this positive screw. Again, make sure that you don't over-tighten these screws so you don't shear off the legs of the coil. So I've got it centered. I'm going to pull it out just a little bit, and I'm going to trim that that negative lead. Okay, so this is what you're looking for. You want those coils to be relatively even in height and relatively even in distance from the center post. That's going to allow you to easier balance the coils when it comes to the heating process. Now we're going to go ahead and switch on the ohm meter. In this particular one, I'm using a USA ohm meter. Any reputable ohm meter will suffice. If you don't have an ohm meter, you can use the ohm meter on your mod. And we can see that it's ohming out at right about a 0.46, which is how this ohm meter reads, about a 0.46, which is lower than the 0.7 that we were going for, but that's normal. For any time that you've tightened up your coils really tight in your wraps, once you get them burning evenly, it will come up closer to the 0.7 in our case, or whichever ohm level you're shooting for. It will come closer to that. Now we're using the Icon 200, which is a regulated mod, to do our test firing on. Always make sure that you adjust the wattage prior to firing, and that way you don't overheat the coil and possibly melt the legs. So here I'm just getting the coil master mandrel back into the coil master itself so I can use it as an adjustment tool to work out any hot spots. Generally speaking, the first hot spot that you're going to notice is on the legs. So just kind of stick your mandrel in and give it a little bit of a wiggle, and that's going to start working out the hot spots. If you need to, just give it a slight rake across the top and just slowly, you know, slowly break in that coil to try to get it burning evenly. If you use the ceramic tweezers like I am here, it'll help you work out the hot spots quicker. You can compress and it allows you to rake quicker while you're firing it without shorting out the coil. Always make sure don't use anything metal while the coil is firing against the coil because that'll cause an immediate short. Okay, so we see that the coil on the far, you know, closer to the top is set up. The screw on that bottom coil actually came a little loose. So here I am, I'm tightening it up. Always double check your screws as you're going through this process because they can loosen up a little bit. So we see that the top one is going almost perfectly. The bottom one is a little bit further behind, so we're going to do a couple last second adjustments, just blowing it off to get it cooled off. And the coil's heating up fairly close. Little quick last adjustment. Top one's heating up a bit quick. Okay, one last strum on the bottom one. And there we go. So we've got that. That's all set and ready. We're going to put that off to the side and we're going to go ahead and get our wicking ready. Now, this is Muji cotton. It's 50 millimeters across by 60 millimeters tall. For 2.5 millimeter coils, I try to use approximately one quarter of the width of the pad per coil. That gives me the adequate wicking that I need. Now, if you're using something like cotton bacon or anything like that, you know, adjust accordingly. Now, if you're looking for Muji cotton, you can definitely go to the Muji website directly, especially if you're in the US, and get it. It's relatively inexpensive. I think I pay like $3.50 a package. So that gives you an option. You don't have to go through Amazon. Now here you see me pulling off the matted front and back layers on each pad, and that's because those matted layers don't allow for optimal wicking, so I never keep those on there. I always take those off, and all you have to do is just peel off the thinnest outer layer on each side. Always double check your coils to make sure that they're nice and cool before inserting your cotton. The last thing you want to do is burn your cotton right off the bat. And just give your cotton a little pinch and a twist, and as you're rolling it, pushing it through, just give it a slight little twisting action, and that'll allow it to come through smoother. Hold the coil in place with your thumbnail to keep it lined up, and then just give it a little wiggle to firmly seat it within the coil itself. Now, the length that you'll want to snip your legs is dependent on what type of RDA you've got. Basically, you want just enough cotton to come down and touch the base of the deck, but you don't want so much that that it actually folds under and starts taking up deck room, which can cause airflow issues later on. So just repeating the same process on the other side, just giving a little wiggle to settle it in inside the coil and trimming the legs of the cotton. Now that we've got the cotton inserted, we're going to take a small little screwdriver. You can use ceramic tweezers or whatever you have handy to tuck the legs of the tails of the cotton down into the juice well. Remember to try to keep them up against the wall of the deck to allow optimal airflow underneath the coil. And you're going to want to do that all the way around on all four tails. And make sure that you have plenty of clearance underneath the coil. You should be able to see the deck or the build posts underneath the coil. That tells you that you've got plenty of airflow going under the coil. Okay, so we're taking the RDA off here to reset the mod. In this way, we can verify that that we've actually got the proper ohm setting for the coil. So I'm just screwing it back on here, and then we'll just let the mod pick up the new reading. And remember, we were shooting for a 0.7, and I think I can get it close enough here, and we can see that it came in at a 0.69. So shooting for a 0.7, coming up with a 0.69, that's going to be pretty accurate. It's going to be hard to get dead on, but if you can come as close as that, you've pretty much done what you need to do. So here I'm just adjusting the wattage to get ready to break in the cotton with the fresh juice. I apologize for it being out of focus here. Again, I'm still working with the new coil or new camera setup. So the way I juice my coils is I get the coil nice and saturated to allow that e-liquid to start working its way to the center of the cotton. While it's doing that, I go through and saturate the tails of the cotton. You don't have to drown your coils. Just enough cotton to saturate, or just enough e-liquid to saturate the cotton is more than enough. The more juice you put on your coils, the more likely you are to get spit back, so keep that in mind. And then just slowly pulse in the coil to get the e-liquid further pulled into the cotton in the middle of that coil. And there we go. Every couple pulses, make sure that you repaint the coil with the e-liquid, and that's going to slowly break in that cotton. Okay, so we've got it nice and broken in here, and the audio is about to pick back up when we move to the other camera. So there we go. And I'm going to let it pick up from the other camera from here on out. Just make sure you adjust your airflow. Okay, so that's how it's done, guys. It's not a difficult coil to build. A little bit of time, a little bit of practice, and you'll knock it out too. Now, I'm going ahead and bumping mine up. I've got it set to about 53 watts at the 0.69 that it ended up at. Flavor's there. It's definitely producing. So, yeah. If you enjoyed the video, give it a like and subscribe to the channel. If you have feedback on how to improve the channel, or if you see a coil on Instagram or wherever and you want to see how it's built, leave a comment down below, and if I see enough comments on a particular build, I'll definitely throw a video together on how to do it. I try to put out new videos every Monday at 2 p.m. Eastern right here, so check back and see what's coming up next. Remember, it's not the cigarettes you smoke, but rather the ones you don't smoke that you should count. It doesn't matter if you're vaping a 0.1 or a 10 ohm coil. As long as it's safe and it satisfies you, that's all that matters. Because at the end of the day, it's your vaping journey that you're going on. So with that being said, I'm going to cut on out of here. Enjoy and be safe about it.